Good evening. I'm Jennifer Raab and have the great privilege of being the president of this extraordinary institution, Hunter College, and a great honor to welcome this incredible standing room only, Joe, crowd to celebrate and to hear tonight this wonderful discussion from Joe Lelyveld about his new book, His Final Battle, The Last Months of Franklin Roosevelt. Roosevelt House is the perfect venue to celebrate the publication of Joe's history of FDR's final year in the White House and the heroic, almost superhuman energy he somehow summoned from a broken body and rapidly deteriorating heart to win not only a fourth election for president, but victory in the largest and deadliest war in the history of mankind. A perfect place, if bittersweet, because it was in this house that two decades before, the once hale and hearty young FDR learned that he could survive and thrive against all physical adversity. Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt, as many of you know, lived here on and off from the time they moved in as newlyweds in 1908 until they left for the White House in January 1933. Roosevelt House plays a significant role in FDR's life because it was here that he came to recover in 1921 from polio. The house, unusually for the time, had an elevator, which was a rarity. He built himself a hand-operated wheelchair and regained a semblance of physical independence in these very quarters. And because of the many bedrooms in the house, Louis Howe could also move in to help FDR get his career back on track, which they did magnificently. It was in this house that FDR and Howe returned after waiting all night at the Biltmore Hotel for the results of the 1928 governor's race. They came home thinking FDR had lost. It wasn't until 4 a.m. that they learned that the numbers had shifted and FDR had been elected the 44th governor of New York. 4 years later, FDR again returned to this house from the Biltmore. This time, his mother, Sarah Delano Roosevelt, greeted him on the steps of the house, the steps you came in on today, as the newly elected president of the United States, saying to him, "This is the happiest day of my life." Hours later, on November 9th, 1932, FDR gave his first radio address upstairs in the room now painted white in the parlor to thank the voters and discuss his economic recovery plans. And because the inauguration was not until March, many of the plans for other New Deal programs, unemployment insurance, federal child labor laws, and minimum wage laws were hatched in these very halls. It was here that Eleanor suggested that FDR consider adding a woman to his cabinet. He interviewed Frances Perkins for the job of Secretary of Labor in the library upstairs, and she accepted only after he agreed to support the creation of a program we know as Social Security. So we are here, with all due respect to Hamilton and its wonderful author and creator, Ron Chernow, in the home where it happened, where FDR recovered his strength and his political will, where FDR's presidency was launched, and a fitting place for Joe to discuss what happened in his final presidential year. There's a second moment of kismet in celebrating Joe Lelyveld's book at Roosevelt House, and that involves Joe's family history, so let me explain. When Sarah died in 1941, the Roosevelts arranged for Hunter College to buy this house for $50,000, one of the best real estate deals in New York, and Franklin himself donated the first $1,000. They envisioned that the house would be used as an interfaith center for Hunter College, saying it would be a place where students would learn, quote, to look on all human beings with respect and to have a true understanding of the points of views of others. And so it was that in November of 1943, Eleanor Roosevelt dedicated this building as the Sarah Delano Roosevelt Interfaith Memorial House. So when FDR began the final year that Joe talks about so brilliantly in his new book, Hunter's students were meeting here, studying here, and founding groups and clubs that welcomed students of all races and religion, including the refugees from the war against fascism that Roosevelt was still fighting to win. One of the first religious groups to move into Roosevelt House was Hunter Hillel. And the director of the Hunter Hillel, based here from 1948 to 1956, was no other than Joe Lelyveld's mother, Toby. She carried out the Roosevelts' vision of an interfaith center by working closely with Hunter's Newman Society and our Protestant groups. She is remembered fondly by Hunter alums and the Jewish leadership in the city. So, Joe, both the Roosevelt spirit and the Lelyveld spirit is very much alive at the college and in this house, and we are so pleased to have you with us this evening. And now to introduce fully our speaker, it is a pleasure to welcome to the podium our own Harold Holzer. Harold is a renowned Lincoln scholar who has written more than 50 books on Lincoln and the political culture of the Civil War, for which he has won accolades including the Gilder Lehrman Lincoln Prize for his most recent book, Lincoln and the Power of the Press. But we are equally, if not more, proud of Harold's leadership here at Hunter, where he enters his second year as the Jonathan Fanton Director of Roosevelt House. Harold is making a difference in the lives of our students, and nothing could be more important. Please welcome Harold Holzer.
Thanks, Jennifer, and let me say what an honor it is to serve in this extraordinary, inspiring house and for the remarkable institution it houses and for the visionary president who leads all of Hunter. So it's a great honor. And to start the fall season officially with this remarkable event is truly astounding. I happen to work, speaking of the current formation of the house, in what was once Sarah Delano Roosevelt's bedroom upstairs on the fourth floor. Joe has told us that his mother worked on the fourth floor. I don't know if it was in the same room, but it was certainly the same staging area. Whether Mrs. Roosevelt ever imagined that her most private space would be occupied by what my former boss and a Hunter alum, Bella Abzug, used to call me, a boy from Queens, we don't know. But I will say how blessed I feel to serve there and being constantly renewed by the Roosevelt family spirit and the mission that we have to continue building on their efforts to bring peace, prosperity, and freedom to the world and enlightenment to our students, as President Raab said. Joe, you can often judge a speaker by his audience. And this one is not only full to capacity, but graced with some of your great peers in the history and biography business, and I want to acknowledge them. Jennifer mentioned Ron Chernow, who I don't see, but I'm sure is here. There's Ron Chernow, the great Ron Chernow. We're thrilled that a biographer of both Roosevelts, Theodore and Franklin, is here, Geoffrey Ward. Welcome, Jeff. Last but not least, the incomparable Bob Caro. And let me acknowledge two special guests who may, one of whom may remember in the corner of her own childhood memories, the final year of her grandfather's storied life, the subject of tonight's event. It's a special honor to welcome Franklin D. Roosevelt's granddaughter, my adored friend Kate Whitney, who is here. Somewhere. There's Kate. Oh, and her daughter, FDR's great-granddaughter and a member of our board of advisors, Luli Hedit, who I've known since she was 2 weeks old, I think. Before I introduce our speaker, let me just remind everyone of the format tonight. Our guest will talk about his new book, and then he'll take questions from the audience. Then you're all invited to a reception that President Raab is hosting upstairs in the Four Freedoms Room, where you can not only join us in toasting tonight's speaker, but also in the mandatory purchase of his new book, which he will be delighted to sign for you. So it, now, at last, it's a pleasure to introduce you. Joseph Lelyveld is the only journalist, I believe, who ever served twice as executive editor of the New York Times. In his longest stint for the 7 years between 1994 and 2001. A graduate of Harvard and the Columbia School of Journalism, he forged a storied four-decade-long career at the paper as a reporter, a foreign correspondent, foreign editor, and managing editor before he became the boss. And somehow he found the time during that period and immediately after to produce some remarkable books. Among them are the acclaimed Move Your Shadow, South Africa, Black and White, based on his reporting from the fading days of apartheid. Omaha Blues, A Memory Loop, his striking family memoir from 2005. And Great Soul, Mahatma Gandhi and His Struggle with India, which won the 2011 Pulitzer Prize. A lot of Pulitzers. It didn't? Did it win? Which it won some major honor. What a jip it was that it didn't win. Well, that certainly mars the seamless introduction that I'm giving. We'll make up for it. There are lots of Pulitzers here. We can just give one to you. So we're here to mark the publication of his latest, his final battle, The Last Months of Franklin Roosevelt. A truly dazzling, illuminating, tragic, moving, and inspiring read. And not surprisingly, the book has won ovations of advance acclaim. I'll just quote one by our friend Gay Talese, who spoke for many early reviewers by noting that the book traces the last challenging months of FDR's life with a pitch-perfect blend of meticulous reporting, careful analysis, and deep humanity. I suspect you may finish the book, wondering not only how FDR found the wellspring of stamina that somehow summoned him to greenlight D-Day and campaign for re-election, choose a running mate who became his successor, but to travel an exhausting 14,000 miles to and from Yalta when he was so desperately ill, operating on a reserve of power that somehow not only kept him going, but kept hope for Allied victory and world peace alive as well. It's a remarkable story, full of insights and surprises, but I will leave it to the historian who has crafted this story to tell us about it. It's an honor to welcome Joe Lelyveld.
I guess I could claim that the inspiration for this book came from Roosevelt House, because I was in and out of this place a lot when I was in grade school and through to high school, I guess, when my mother was working here. But it's not true. it was a stressful time in her life and in the life of our family, and she was making a transition really from affairs Jewish to what she really hoped to devote her life to, which was literary scholarship. And at the same time, she was working on a PhD on The Merchant of Venice at Columbia, which she ultimately got. I'm not sure which year. But so I think I don't know how she looked back at Roosevelt House in later years, with some fondness for the people, I'm sure, but it was not with a warm glow, I would guess. But that poses the question of how I got to this book, and I don't really have an answer. It's kind of embarrassing. It's the question I'm most often asked, and the awkward truth is I can't remember. At some point 4 or 5 years ago, when I was had brought out my previous book on Mahatma Gandhi, I read something somewhere that drew my attention to this not conspicuously spiritual figure, Franklin Roosevelt. It wasn't a book. It may have been nothing more than a paragraph in an article or a review. But whatever it was, it started me thinking and poking around in libraries and eventually led me to the FDR Presidential Library at Hyde Park, where I did some more poking around. What drew me on, what I found myself wondering about, getting a little fixated on, was the puzzle of Roosevelt's most intimate thoughts on the question of his own mortality in this period. the ultimate existential question. In broader terms, the puzzle of what it was that kept him, our longest serving president, going after all those years of stress in the midst of the most destructive war in human history. Was it a sense of duty or self-sacrifice, or was he, as we sometimes now say on this sensitive end-of-life topic, in denial, as it's fair to say most of us are, day in, day out. Not to be morbid, there was one fact in this connection I couldn't entirely ignore. I was already, when I started thinking about FDR, years older than he was at the end of his life. He was just 63 on the day he died, April 12, 1945, 71 years ago now. I'm old enough to remember that day the way many of us remember November 22, 1963, and all of us remember September 11, 2001. All of us except perhaps my granddaughter, who I believe is here. There she is. She wouldn't remember that. She was 3 days old. On that long ago April day, my favorite radio serial, I think it was Captain Midnight, was interrupted by the fateful bulletin from Warm Springs, Georgia. This was how they did things in radio days before social media. A deep disembodied voice came out of a box. It said, we interrupt this program to bring you an important news bulletin. President Roosevelt is dead, or words to that effect. These were followed by doleful orchestral music, then more bulletins. Captain Midnight didn't return for several days. Could be my interest in this subject started there, but I don't really think so. I think I was doing what I've done through a long career as a reporter. I was sensing a story that seemed to me hadn't been fully told. The time span I cover in my book is ostensibly very limited, just 17 months, not quite a year and a half, as I finally conceived it, measuring from the day Roosevelt left the White House in November 1943 to sail to the Mediterranean en route to Tehran to meet Joseph Stalin, the Soviet dictator, which had been a major aim of his for several years by then, from there until the fatal day in Warm Springs. Obviously, these 17 months can't tell the whole story. It's necessary to bend the chronology forward and back to see the big picture. For instance, you can't begin to understand, I submit, Roosevelt's determination to engage Stalin face to face, as he did for the first time at Tehran, without referring back to his experience as a second-tier official in the Woodrow Wilson administration during World War I. That left him with a determination this time around to shape the post-war order as he believed Wilson had failed to do in his day. Some people write that that Wilson was his idol and he was doing this to honor Wilson. I think he had a very ambivalent feeling about Wilson, and he was doing this to avoid Wilson's errors. Even before Pearl Harbor, Roosevelt was preoccupied with the question of how this might be accomplished.
He had no pat answer. This famously pragmatic politician really didn't deal in pat answers. But the question of how he could succeed where Wilson failed was never far from his mind. I think I can personally handle Stalin better than either your Foreign Office or my State Department, he wrote to Churchill early on. Properly handled, the dictator might be the key to victory and the post-war world. Obviously, it was not a sure thing. In Roosevelt's mind, it was a proposition to be tested. Tehran was to be the first test. Similarly, the chronology has to be bent. There's another point I think I should insert there about Roosevelt and Stalin at Tehran. Stalin gets up and gives a remarkable toast to Roosevelt and says that without him and his decision to send lend-lease assistance to the Soviet Union after Hitler launched Operation Barbarossa, as it was called, attacking Russia, his former ally, he said, without Roosevelt, we could not win this war, and it's perhaps one of the few high points of Soviet-American relations over the decades. Similarly, the chronology has to be bent. The backstory has to be sketched in if we were to find meaning in the place he made in his crowded life for his old love, Lucy Mercer Rutherford, in his last months. The drama inherent in the fact that it was Lucy, not Eleanor, who was with him when he was felled by a hemorrhage on the brain in Warm Springs. My 17 months are packed with history with a capital H. Huge events involving this president, the D-Day landings in Normandy, a half year after the summit in Tehran, the largest amphibious assault ever and likely to remain so, the decision to proceed with building the atomic bomb, FDR's long postponed announcement that he'd stand for a fourth term in 1944, his stealthy maneuvering to drop his starry-eyed vice president, Henry Wallace, from the ticket in favor, finally, of a little-known Missouri senator, a hard-fought campaign at a time when no other Democrat was given a chance of winning. We're so used to the idea that Roosevelt was a supreme figure in the time and one of our great presidents that we don't easily take aboard the thought that his political strength was actually waning. All through this period. The 1942 election, less than a year after Pearl Harbor, I believe, if I'm remembering correctly, the Democrats lost 45 seats in the House of Representatives. So I was going down my list of great things that happened in these 17 months. That was not one of them. The election was soon followed by the Battle of the Bulge, Adolf Hitler's big gamble on a counterattack, which proved to be virtually the last gasp of the Third Reich. Roosevelt's long, perilous trip to Yalta in the Crimea on the Black Sea for a second meeting with Stalin and Churchill, leading to agreement on the United Nations and Soviet intervention on our side against Japan in the Pacific War, and crucially a compromise on Poland that hardly stood a chance. Roosevelt himself recognized, since Stalin's Red Army had already occupied the country, to mention a few highlights. And here's a sidelight that's seldom pointed out. By picking Truman as his understudy and earlier Dwight Eisenhower to be Supreme Commander in Europe, both surprise choices in their day, FDR, as time would show, chose not only his successor, but his successor's successor. All these matters have been written about at length, over and over. All have given rise to controversies that still can't be deemed settled. But Roosevelt himself tends to recede in many of these standard accounts. He was too easily presumed long after the fact to have been a dying man, losing his grip on affairs in the midst of all these big events. After all, he did die. Yet somehow he managed to remain a convincing president, really to the end. His actual medical condition was never disclosed in his lifetime, and his medical records disappeared, were presumably destroyed afterwards. Whether he had anything to do with that or not, it's hard to tell, but it's a good guess who did, the White House physician. He took care, as he always had, to cover his tracks, and not just when it came to matters medical. This was the most private of public men, charming, outgoing to the point of being loquacious, but also exceedingly guarded, making Hillary Clinton seem, by contrast, a font of self-revelation. He kept no diary, forbade the taking of minutes at his meetings, met the press regularly, normally twice a week, but almost always in that pre-television age, on an off-the-record basis. The official count on the number of his press conferences as president came to 998. The last one in Warm Springs, a week before his death, ended with the president reminding the journalists that everything he'd said on a Soviet claim for extra votes in the General Assembly of the still gestating United Nations had been off the record. He was still in good form. The very few who were later thought to have been his intimates and confidants got only peeks into his thinking, which is only natural because his thinking was always changing. It was in a constant state of flux and revision, never static, as situations in the political climate changed. The president doesn't think, Eleanor once said, he decides. Frances Perkins, who, as Harold said, was the first woman in a cabinet office, said he had a four-track mind. He was simultaneously a visionary, an opportunist, and a political schemer, ready to test a hypothesis in politics like a scientist in a lab or an entrepreneur with a risky business plan. He also had a deep habit of procrastination, dedicated to keeping his political, diplomatic, and personal options open as long as he possibly could. He could stand on all sides of an issue when it suited him, his purpose. Visitors with opposing points of view would leave his office feeling they'd persuaded the president to see things their way, seldom noticing that he'd made no commitments whatsoever, had in fact changed their outlook and expectations and plans. Highly principled in his aims, he was routinely duplicitous in his tactics. A juggler, Roosevelt himself said, ready to lie if it would help win the war. The British military historian John Keegan called him by far the most enigmatic leading figure of World War II. I prefer the word inscrutable. It applies on the political home front too. In the same few days in July 44, he simultaneously led a pair of would-be candidates for the position of his running mate, candidates for vice president, I'm speaking here of Henry Wallace and Jimmy Burns, to believe that each had his full support for the nomination while working all the time to block them and instructing others to go tell them they didn't have a chance. On behalf of a third man to whom he never directly spoke, Henry Wallace aptly called him a waterman, capable of looking in one direction while rowing in another. In these wartime months, his instinct for secretiveness could be justified on the basis of national security. Under a supposedly voluntary censorship agreement with reporters covering the White House and with their news organizations, the actual whereabouts of the president was treated as a state secret, not just when he traveled abroad to Casablanca or Tehran or Yalta, but also in the United States. He was actually away from the White House in this period more than in it. He loved traveling around by train, usually to Hyde Park. Congress, the public at large, and cabinet members often didn't know where he was. He made 21 trips of varying length to Hyde Park in those 17 months on a presidential train that departed late at night from the basement of the Bureau of Engraving across the mall from the White House, riding in his own specially outfitted armor-plated railway car called the Ferdinand Magellan, which now, if you happen to be in Miami, can be visited just outside the zoo at what's called the Gold Coast Railway Museum. It's in they've refurbished it, and it's in very good shape. I think you learn a lot by walking through that railway car because I think most of us would find the idea of spending a week confined to that small space, a very oppressive prospect. Roosevelt found it liberating because he was freed from all the people who called on him at the White House, and he got to look out the window and see the passing country, and nobody knew where he was. This to him was bliss. In April 1944, as D-Day approached, he spent a month on what amounted to medical rehab at a plantation in the Low Country on the South Carolina coast. All that time, the closest the New York Times came to disclosing his whereabouts and condition was to say in a subordinate clause in a brief and conspicuous dispatch that he was somewhere in the South. A line in David Herbert Donald's
fine biography of Lincoln helped inspire me finally to give this elusive subject a shot. He said it had been his ambition to produce a biography written from Lincoln's point of view, using information and ideas available to him, seeking to explain rather than to judge. I came to feel no one had done that in this period for FDR. After some months of intermittent exploration, I concluded with a reporter's opportunism that there was ample room, despite all that had been written, for such a book on Roosevelt. The opening was there in part because some of the most dedicated and industrious Roosevelt biographers and scholars never got to the end of his life. Arthur Schlesinger's Age of Roosevelt was still in the 1930s after three volumes when it ended. Kenneth Davis died after his first three volumes, which took his subject through to 1943. Frank Friedel, an old professor of mine, the earliest scholar to plan a multi-volume treatment, started a fifth volume but left it unfinished, worn out probably. Meanwhile, new information and insights surfaced over the years. There were the clinical notes, Roosevelt's Navy cardiologist, in civilian life, a New York specialist named Howard Bruin, eventually published in a medical journal 25 years after his patient died. Frank Leahy, a noted surgeon, founder of the Leahy Clinic, now a major medical center north of Boston, was called in as a consultant on Roosevelt and later left a letter for posterity, dictated a day before FDR declared for a fourth term. It said bluntly that he wouldn't be able to survive it. Much later, after a prolonged court battle over the issue of patient confidentiality, with the Leahy Clinic and the Roosevelt Library lined up on opposing sides, the doctor's letter finally came into the public domain in 2007, less than 10 years ago. I have a private theory, which I can't prove, but nonetheless, delighted in putting in print in my book, that the real fight wasn't between the Leahy Clinic and the Roosevelt Library. It was between the Kennedy family and Roosevelt scholars, because Joe Kennedy had been one of the big supporters of the Leahy Clinic, and Jack Kennedy had been a patient there from the age of 12, and their medical records were all at the Leahy Clinic. I presume they're still there, and they didn't want people prying. So patient confidentiality was a big issue for them. Nobody was fighting to suppress the scraps of Frank Leahy's ventures to Washington to see Roosevelt.
Most helpful to me were the Daisy Suckley diaries. Daisy was a Hudson Valley neighbor and distant cousin who spent more time during the war years alone with the president than anyone else, including his wife, Eleanor. Daisy then survived him by nearly half a century, always insisting she had saved no notes or correspondence. After she died in 1991 in her 100th year, an old leather valise was hauled from under her bed in her dilapidated mansion near Rhinebeck, New York. Inside was her diary, which Geoffrey Ward then did a masterful job of editing in a volume aptly entitled Closest Companion. And Jeff was a great support to me as I worked on this book. And I don't know if I ever put it so directly, but I think it's obvious in the book how important the seemed to me it was to mine the Daisy's entries. You could overstate the importance and you could overinterpret what she wrote, and she wasn't very consistent, and there were a lot of things she didn't know about, and Roosevelt didn't pour out his heart to her or anyone, but if you took those those entries and lined them up against the official day-by-day log of Roosevelt's activities, which now can be read on the website of the Roosevelt Library at Hyde Park, they were often very revealing. The Suckley Diaries, I would say, supply the mood music for the president's last months, a kind of up and down recitative in which his hopes, worries, and calculations find telling, highly variable expression. These and similar late discoveries now made it possible to adopt Professor Donald's standard and attempt a book about this climactic period of his life and presidency from Roosevelt's point of view, to explain his thinking rather than judge him, in simplest terms, to tell a story. In reviewing the choices with which he was confronted through his eyes, or attempting to do so, it seemed to become clear to me that they didn't really present themselves to him as choices. At the end of 1943, on his return from Tehran, he appeared to be in radiant good health, if you leave aside the constant of his crippling infirmity. Everyone commented on how good he looked, and you can see it in the photographs. The timeline matters. Only 3 months later, his Navy cardiologist diagnosed him with congestive heart failure, a diagnosis that then wasn't revealed for 26 years. Congestive heart failure is not a fatal diagnosis today. There are a number of things that that doctors can do. In those days, it was very close to being a fatal diagnosis because there were some things they could do to mitigate the problem, but there was nothing they could do to to clear it up, and eventually it's the wear and tear on the cardiovascular system would inevitably be enormous. When this diagnosis was made, and of course very few people knew about it, there were then only 2 months remaining to D-Day and 6 weeks more to the Democratic Convention. Here's another point where it's really necessary to dwell on the timeline. I asked myself, what exactly could Franklin Roosevelt do at that point? How could he begin to step aside? I mean, with a million American servicemen in Britain waiting to hit the beaches in Normandy, it wasn't the right time to say, I'm out of here. And he, of course, had months left under the Constitution in the term he was then serving, and it wasn't a good time to, propitious time to look for a successor. If you view it in the context of the World War and the fact that everything now turned on the Normandy invasion, he was stuck. At one time, he may have wondered whether an early end to the war in Europe might give him an opportunity to bow out. But that consummation didn't come soon enough. Given those interlocking timetables for the invasion and the convention, he was in no position to look for an exit. He couldn't conceivably say he was getting out, and carrying on was a more obvious choice than getting out. In a sense, he was trapped. He told himself and a few others that he could always resign if it got to be too much. I don't think he ever really decided to run again for the fourth term. He just ran out of time. He was hoping something would come along, and nothing did. This is a classic case of Roosevelt procrastination. I mean, he announced that he would be a candidate for a fourth term, surprising no one. Wendell Willkie, who was still alive, was asked, "Did you hear the news? Roosevelt's running." And he said, "Do you call that news?" But
I think there were 8 days left to the convention when he finally announced that he was a candidate. So it would put it in the context of our year and a half campaigns, it's kind of hard to imagine. A couple of vignettes stick in my mind when I consider FDR's valor in these months. One is a visit he paid to the wards of a naval hospital in the hills above Honolulu, to which amputees and other severely wounded survivors of the assault on the island of Saipan had been delivered. Roosevelt, who never allowed himself to be photographed in public in his everyday conveyance, his wheelchair, had the Secret Service wheel him through those wards from bed to bed so the wounded airman could draw courage from the example of a commander-in-chief who hadn't been able to take a single step unassisted for nearly a quarter of a century. Theirs was a kind of communion. The other image also involves his wheelchair. The day after his return from Yalta, arriving at the Capitol to address Congress for what would prove to be the final time, he had himself wheeled down the aisle and transferred to an armchair, from which he spoke in a seated position at the foot of the podium where he'd previously stood, explaining matter-of-factly, without a hint of self-pity, "It makes it a lot easier not to have to carry 10 pounds of steel around on the bottom of my legs." This was the first and only public acknowledgement in those 12-plus presidential years of his infirmity. Francis Perkins called it one more spiritual inner victory for him in his long adjustment. A staunchly anti-Roosevelt columnist in the New York Daily News named John O'Donnell, who was a great polemicist but no friend of Roosevelt, wrote that even his grimmest political foes were stirred by the crippled president's brisk allusion to what had previously been unmentionable. It reawakened, the columnist wrote, their honest appreciation of the undoubted personal courage and fighting heart of the man who was about to tell them what he had done in the name of the Republic. It blew away some of the fumes of personal bitterness. Applause swept the chamber from both sides of the aisle. I'll end with an obvious thought, too obvious perhaps, but unavoidable, I feel, in this really dismal political season. It's that we don't hear such grace notes in our own era. Maybe before next January 20th, Mitch McConnell or the likes of Sean Hannity will find something halfway decent to say about Barack Obama. But don't bet on it. Thank you.
Did Roosevelt survive the opening of the San Francisco conference on the founding of the UN?
No, he died a couple of, he was planning to leave in about 10 days from Warm Springs for Washington and then to take a train to San Francisco, and he was just beginning to draft the speech he would deliver in San Francisco, but he had it very much in mind, but he didn't get there.
It's interesting timing, this talk, considering what's going on today. Was that your idea? Was that Jennifer's to pull it on today? Anyhow, the question is, Roosevelt, from what I understand, was shrouded in secrecy about his health. Always. And we're witnessing the same thing today, and it's not exactly the same, but there's certainly a lot of similarities, and I'd like you to comment on the similarities and what your opinion of all this is.
Well, I don't think it's the same thing. First of all, we don't know the extent of Mrs. Clinton's illness, but if it's what they say, it's not at all the same thing, because Roosevelt's problems were actually life-threatening at the end of his life. She was diagnosed with pneumonia, we're told, on Friday, and she stumbled on Sunday. Is that right? Sunday, and had those embarrassing videos taken, and then reappeared. Nothing happened to Roosevelt like that because photographers simply were not allowed to photograph him. The degree of control he had over the White House press corps is unimaginable today. And he saw them twice a week, but there are, I think, if I'm not mistaken, three photographs of Roosevelt in a wheelchair, none of them taken by press people. And none of them published in his lifetime, as far as I know. So it's a different degree of control. And the orders that he was not to be photographed in difficult situations came from him directly, and were policed by people on the staff of the White House. So if he was adjusting his braces on an occasion when he was wearing them, that was not to be shown. If the Secret Service was lifted, they would carry him out of a car by just lifting him like a small child, and carry him into the place he was going if the surroundings were private enough. None of that was widely known, photographed, discussed, even in his last term. After, you know, an interesting side, Jeff Ward and I have talked about this a fair amount, and I think we agree that a lot of people discovered after Roosevelt died that they knew all along he was dying. But the evidence of the if you look for occasions when they've found it possible to say that or write it while he was alive, they're few and far between. And even in the last campaign, when his health did become an open issue, and was written about, especially by editorial writers, it was done with great caution and great circumspection, and it wasn't a day-by-day pounding such as we get now. We've heard more about Hillary Clinton's health in the last 5 days than the whole of the United States heard about Franklin Roosevelt's health during World War II. I think that's a fair statement. So I don't know if I covered your whole question, but I don't think there are the impulses may be the same, but the situation is so totally different. Hi.
Did you come across any new material that would bear on the still burning question of the state of his mind and his health at the altar, and did it affect the decision making?
I think Chip Boland, who I think is the best witness because he was his interpreter in every conversation he ever had with Stalin, testified in his memoir that Roosevelt was sharp, mentally sharp, and alert through all of that. He was sick, dying, I think, at that point, but had a grip on what was going on, and I think if you follow the sequence of the actual diplomatic discussions. Roosevelt, the leading scholars on Yalta, three or four who've written the best books, it seems to me, all agree that Roosevelt was a major force at the meeting, and it's clearly the decision maker on the American side. It's very hard. It's easy to point to things that didn't turn out ideally, Poland in particular, but it's very hard to find instances of things where he could have done something else
and deals were being made. Stalin was very clever. I just reading the transcripts. There's a point in the about the third or fourth day of the Yalta Conference where the Russians, who have been taking a very hard position on the way they want the UN to be organized, come in one morning and throw the whole thing over. They say Roosevelt's ready to talk about Poland, and Stalin says, "No, Mr. Molotov has something to tell you." And Molotov says, "The demands we made for 16 votes in the General Assembly will be satisfied with 2 or 3. I can't remember exactly what the other points were, but he said the Russians basically withdraw their whole position and embrace the American position. Then they're ready to talk about Poland. It's like a chess game. And I think Roosevelt makes it clear that he's not satisfied to go away with a communique that says they couldn't agree on Poland. He wants some face-saving gestures, not just his face, but for the Poles. And he's hoping for some border adjustments. He wants the old Galician city of Lemberg, now Lvov, to be handed over to the Poles. He has a bunch of things he's asking for. He doesn't think they're very great. It won't change the things very much for the Russians. They'll still have the border they want, and he pushes hard for it. He doesn't get it. Stalin won't budge on it. And at that point, there's some indications in Dr. Brun's notes that Roosevelt's health took a momentary dip because he was so distressed by the way the discussion on Poland went. But you know, they came. Most of the American delegation thought that we had come out of the discussions very well. The Russians bought our program for the UN. They agreed to come into the Pacific War against Japan. A lot of things were pinned down, and I think there's some evidence that FDR saw through this, but they signed everything. The language suddenly changed. Stalin was now ready to sign on to the Declaration of Liberated Europe, and which he did in 3 or 4 minutes, and to promise a democratic Poland, but I think Roosevelt understood that he was not getting what the words seemed to represent, but he was getting a more palatable representation of what the commitment was. And you have to remember that Roosevelt wasn't planning to die immediately, so for him, the thing had gone about as far as it could go at Yalta, but it wasn't necessarily over. There could be further discussions, and the Russians did make some commitments that they then promptly broke, which is a whole other story. But the events in Romania that followed Yalta were very dark. There was essentially a communist coup there, and the Americans understood that. Roosevelt understood that. But on the vast canvas of what was happening in World War II, these were very negative weights, but it wasn't the whole story. And it was very important for him to come home and have a story to tell the American people. And I don't mean a fable, but that this was all worth something. We're creating a better world, and he wasn't prepared to come home and say, "Well, now buckle your seatbelts, we're about to have a Cold War." So how he would have played it had he lived and been vigorous, it's hard to say. I don't think it would have gone well. But I think from everything I can see, he was very much au courant with the play-by-play of Yalta.
By April of 1945, Roosevelt knew exactly what had happened to the Jews in Europe, even though most Americans did not. I'm wondering whether there was any indication about what he thought about the establishment of a state or a refuge. As you know, his successor, Truman, was finally, his hand was pushed into recognizing the state of Israel and to take a stand.
Story, sure.
But I'm wondering if Roosevelt had any ideas on what lay ahead or what he would have wanted the future of the
keep myself, since we've talked about that, my mother at the Hillel Foundation, from pointing out that my 32-year-old father called on Truman with his former haberdashery partner, Eddie Jacobson, and on behalf of the Zionist organization, and got what he thought was a commitment to support the state. There's a wonderful story that I tell in this book of two rabbis, Abba Hillel Silver and Stephen Wise, the most prominent rabbis of their day, call on Roosevelt at the White House and ask him to support the establishment of a Jewish state in Palestine. I think it's 1943. He has just made the strongest statement he's made about what was happening in the camp, stronger than anything I had understood that he had made. But he didn't make it in a national address, but he did put out a statement talking about the barbarism of what the Nazis were doing. And he told them that they absolutely had his support for the establishment of a Jewish state in Palestine, but because of the British and a few other things in the alliance during the war, he couldn't say it explicitly, but he would say it as soon as the war was over. And so the next day he's meeting the cabinet, and he recounts the conversation to the cabinet. Henry Wallace has seen Abba Hillel Silver, the rabbi, in between his meeting with Roosevelt and the subsequent cabinet meeting. And Silver is delighted and very pleased by how forthcoming Roosevelt was. Then Wallace writes in his diary what Roosevelt actually said at the cabinet meeting. He said, so I told them, what are you trying to do, start a holy jihad? I think this is where Wallace makes that wonderful remark about he's a waterman. He can row in one direction and look in the other. He didn't give any inkling to the cabinet that he had said anything like what the rabbis reported he had said. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. I'm sure there's more about this in the book, but I'm fascinated to know in the circles, the personal circles closest to him, so family, cousins, close advisors, what different degrees of knowledge did he share anything with them about his concerns about his health, and then separately, which of them has written indicating that they were pretty sure that this was the last year?
The only one who, I don't think he shared anything with anyone. I see no indication of that. Subsequently, Eleanor writes that we all knew that he was in poor health, but that if he thought he needed to go on, that it was his duty to go on, all we could do was support him. But she clearly didn't realize how dire it was, although she was worried. Daughter Anna had a couple of conversations. His eldest child, then Anna Boettinger, had a couple of conversations with the cardiologist. One down in South Carolina in the spring, and another one at Yalta. And she had her letters home to her husband indicate that it's the old ticker problem, and that's the term she uses. And she then says, she describes what they, how hard it is to do anything about it, because nobody knows. Only three people at Yalta know how serious the situation is, meaning herself and the two doctors. And one of the doctors has told her not to tell the other doctor that she knows. So I think it's just remarkable how reticent Roosevelt could be when he wanted to be. Hi.
Thanks so much for this beautiful book, by the way. It's extraordinary.
Well, thank you for saying that.
Question, I'm not sure whether I'm asking for explanation or judgment, but in this context, could you say a bit about Roosevelt's selection of Harry Truman, and more than that, treatment of the vice president after he was vice president, namely the relative absence of information or consultation?
Well, can I do that backwards? My point of view on the relative absence of, there was really no consultation or briefing of Harry Truman to prepare him for the responsibilities. Part of that is Roosevelt still isn't planning to die. Part of that is he's hardly confiding in the Secretary of War or the chairman of the chief of staff of the army. But I think you have to step back and look at the office of the vice presidency. Up to that point, no vice president had had an office in the White House, if I'm not mistaken. They were all like the character in the Gershwin musical of the I Sing, Alexander Throttlebottom. They hung out on Capitol Hill, where they didn't amount to much if they didn't serve drinks, which Wallace didn't. Truman and Roosevelt were in Washington at the same time as vice president and president, only 21 days. They saw each other two or three times during that period. As far as I can see, never alone. Truman told his daughter that Roosevelt never briefed him on anything. I think that would be consistent with the whole history of the vice presidency and the whole history of the way Roosevelt shared information within his administration. Perhaps later he would have if he had lived another few weeks. But the other thing is, Roosevelt, on many of these issues, couldn't say on April 12, 1945, exactly what he was planning to do about Stalin or how he was going to use the bomb. Because Roosevelt always took such major decisions at the last possible moment. He contemplated all possibilities, but they just continued to spin in his mind. And so my view is that there was no briefing to be done, and that in the end it didn't matter if you're thinking about the bomb, because Truman got a thorough briefing within 2 weeks. He was told the night he was sworn in by Henry Stimson about there was this major thing he had to be told about, and a great briefing was prepared for him. And then they set up a process of deciding what to do. If Roosevelt had left a kind of declaration of what he wanted done about the bomb, it's not at all clear that it would have been dispositive. The responsibility, the authority would end the moment his life ended, and the responsibility became Truman's.
So I think Truman missed having one of the most fascinating evenings of his life if Roosevelt had actually spilled his guts on these major issues which he was confronting. But since Roosevelt never did that for anyone, it just didn't happen. But if it had happened, I don't think things would have worked out any differently.
How are you, Joe, by the way? Question deals with the atomic energy issue in the nuclear bomb. And knowing that Roosevelt was secretive, and knowing that he was a very shrewd politician, certainly by April, he must have known that in a few months, there would be bombs not researched, but developed and created. Well,
he'd given the order to go ahead with the development.
But did he at all go into the question of how was the bomb to be used? Because after Truman had used it in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, some people, not a majority of the people, said that there should have been a trial test of something that had such destructive power, perhaps South Pacific Island.
This idea was raised by the people who were charged with deciding what to do about the bomb, and the answer they got back from George Marshall and Henry Stimson was, first of all, there were only two bombs.
That's true.
And if they had a test, nobody had ever dropped one before. They didn't know whether it would be a dud. And if it was a dud, what would the effect of that be on the Japanese? And then they'd have only one bomb. I'm off. They did have a test, so they had three bombs at that point. But they thought it was perilous to do it. The whole small upper strata of the military that knew something about this were opposed to the idea of a test. The most interesting idea I saw was in article by Samuel Elliott Morrison, who had been the official historian of the Navy, a great Harvard historian, and he thought that Roosevelt might have seized upon a proposal made by a man named Joseph Grew, who was the Undersecretary of State at this point. Roosevelt by now is dead, but that idea was that you would simultaneously tell the Japanese about the bomb, and tell them if they surrendered, they could keep their emperor. He said Roosevelt might have gone for that kind of thing. But that was just speculation, and that article was written a year or so after the bomb and after Roosevelt's death. The bomb wasn't developed for the Japanese. It was developed for the Germans who were seeking to build a bomb. The fear was that the Germans would have the bomb first. Nobody was worried about the Japanese having the bomb first. And you can still get a debate on the question of whether the bomb actually ended the war, or whether it was other circumstances that ended the war. Because Japan was essentially blockaded by the time the bomb was dropped, and Russians were coming into the war. There are some people who believe that the Japanese High Command was more concerned about having to fight the Russians than it was about having Nagasaki wiped out. But I don't know if there's any real verdict on that now.
Mm-hmm. My question is about Roosevelt and bombing the camps, the concentration camps, the extermination camps. And why in the 40s, when the war was well on its way to its end, after D-Day, why Roosevelt never took the time to deal with what was really left to be one of the great moral questions. More Jews died in the last year.
Sorry, that's me.
Oh. More Jews died in the last year of the war than any other year. About 1.5 million Jews were killed. We had the aerial capacity. We had the ability, because the German Air Force was no longer a factor, to bomb those camps and save probably hundreds of thousands, maybe 1 million lives. Why didn't Roosevelt do anything?
First of all, it's not clear to me, maybe it is clear, that the issue was ever presented in those terms to Roosevelt. But I think it was dealt with within the War Department when the appeals were made. I haven't seen any. I may be a failure in my research, but I haven't seen any example of Rabbi Wise or Rabbi Silver going to whether he. But the idea was floating around. Whether it got to him is not clear. Go like that. There's a book by a man named Vinnick that makes this case. But first of all, if you bombed the trains and you bombed the camps, you would have killed thousands of Jews who were. And the answer in the book is they were going to die anyway. I don't think that's a terrific answer. Roosevelt was a much more difficult mission than you indicate. We were still flying from one point in Italy and Britain. We were bombing with hundreds of planes every night the industrial areas of Germany. We had been bombing their railroad tracks for months at that point, really half a year at least, and they had been restoring them with remarkable speed and efficiency. And we kept on bombing the same tracks to interfere with their industrial production and their movements of arms. I think from the point of view of the military men, there was no military objective. You weren't going to save a lot of Jewish lives, and you were going to take a lot of planes out of commission from serious military missions. I think it would have been perhaps an impressive gesture, but Roosevelt was not a man for impressive gestures. And if it had gotten to him, I can't imagine that he would have embraced the idea.